Welcome.
Hello there. Well, here we are, The Phantom Menace 7M3 End Credits Part 3, XXXX, Anakin's theme. The final one. Sort that out. That was a bit strange. This is it, folks. This is the last cue from The Phantom Menace. It's been an extraordinary journey. There's a lot to say about this particular theme, so I'm just going to kick off try not to get too emotional as we come to the end of this. But it's such a beautiful track, this one, and very unusual. It's sparsely orchestrated, so at the beginning it's just winds, then strings and harp, and that pretty much remains the same until bassoons, clarinets come in, and then we've got sort of cornglay and horns come in a little bit later on as well, where it goes much more into the sort of Imperial March, and then it dissipates into the ether before the second film. So really interesting and lovely. So first thing is that opening idea is really extraordinary. So they always say, don't they, in melody writing, when you're a school kid or college student, never write a tritone. Well, this is a good example of when to write a tritone, and when to accentuate it. So we've got this sort of interesting, I guess you might call it a sort of a Lydian melody in the key of E, in terms of how it starts. It's an interesting one. So that Lydian ascent, it's a Bach chorale, Est Ist Genug, which Berg used in his violin concerto. So a couple of things. A retardation is basically an upwardly resolving cadence, a bit like that sort of idea, that sort of, you know, where you might have a dominant over a tonic. But I've used it in terms of where you have an appoggiatura, basically, which then leans upwards. Usually something that's sharpened wants to go higher, and something that's flattened wants to go lower. So things like this, especially if they're harmonized, you know, like that, it just wants to go to E. So there's no point talking about the chord here, because really the chord is the resolved chord that we need to get to. So in terms of sort of harmony, it's reasonably straightforward in terms of the actual chords that are used, but of course there's all this sort of chromatic intricacy, which is really, really extraordinary. And even sort of little things here where you get added notes quite high up. So when it, in you know, goes into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, I guess 7 separate parts, because everything else is chordal apart from the melody. That's really extraordinary. You know, most people write 4-part harmony. Here there is 7 part harmony. So it is quite complicated in terms of all the voice leading. Let's just look at the accompaniment. So that move is a Lydian move. So this harmonic move is repeated throughout John Williams's theme writing. There are two types. Ones which I've identified are the sort of the Yoda theme and E.T. flying theme. So that's Yoda's theme. The second chord's bass, so the second type, is the second chord's bass is the same as the first chord's. In other words, it just continues, it's prolonged. So the main theme, section B, Leia's theme, Han and Leia's theme, Luke and Leia, Qui-Gon's funeral, which is actually Luke and Leia's based on the main theme, Qui-Gon's funeral, Anakin and Padme, the asteroid field main theme, the Neapolitan emergency, all sorts of things that happen where that sort of idea, where you just simply have the second chord as a static chord. So it's an interesting one. So before we had looked at the type of theme where he has a bit of movement, an interesting interval, and then descending movement, which is sort of an inversion of the previous one. Let's have a look at this one. So we've got ascending movement. We've then got, I think that is a significant interval. So it's not quite the same, but look at the rhythm. Ba di 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 da. Ba da 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 ba. It is a repetition. Bar 2 is a repetition of bar 1, and it descends from the significant interval. Now, this is just an introduction, of course. It's not the main theme. E is prolonged from here. So this is a sort of, you know, the climax of the phrase. So now, dum dee dee da da da. So now we've got two quavers instead of just one crotchet. And now we've just got a little coda at the end, which again is resolving on E. So E is prolonged all the way through. But back to the harmony. We've got sort of E. We've got that F sharp over E. We've got sort of G diminished. And then a sort of retardation, or let's call it a sort of double suspension, maybe. Uh, another retardation in E, which is sort of, there's no fifth in there. Well, we have got a fifth, sorry, there's no G at that point, which is interesting. So really it's that sort of F, really it's that sort of harmony. So it's actually the F sharp, that sort of F sharp half diminished. I think it's sort of really half diminished. Let's go half dim, see whether it does it. Yeah. And then resolves. So that's a nice sort of unusual sort of mixed plagal cadence, in the sense that two is a substitute for chord four. So 2-7-1, it's that sort of Hollywood, that sort of Hollywood cadence, really. And then we find out that E actually is the whole dominant of the main tune, which is an A. But of course, you know, he doesn't stick to A. Let's look at right at the end of the thing. Oh, he does eventually get back to A, actually. That's interesting. But it doesn't necessarily stick to it, because it shifts around quite a lot. So anyway, we'll come back to that. That was interesting, wasn't it? Sort of didn't even realise that it ended in A and started in the same key that it ended in. Doesn't always, not always the case. So the same Lydian move. So it goes up one chord. And this time it catches up with itself. But of course, you know, all of this is sort of all arpeggiated. Like that. So we've got sort of nice arpeggiations. He could have started with the E there, couldn't he? But by starting with the D sharp, he has a sort of weird resolution in the wrong, part, which is interesting, because that E, that D sharp doesn't resolve to E until there in that part, and even then, it doesn't really resolve, it only sort of resolves again in a different part. So it's an interesting sort of bit of voice leading here, and that's all just arpeggiations. In other words, they're chord tones. And it's a nice example of how to get some movement in things, crack open those appassionata strings from Spitfire Audio and you'll be fine, or synchron strings by Vienna. So here we go. Now look at that voice leading. So we've got the tune, so we so it climbs up, doesn't it? It's that sort of, so it's quite bland where you sort of do that. There's nothing sort of really in that. But the real clue is that, that's the interest. Then it shifts. Shifts. Shifts again. And that's the DNA of the Imperial March. That there. It literally is D and A. And an E. So it's that sort of arpeggiated sequence of going up and then coming back down again. So, yeah. And I quite like that, because it's sort of rather wistful, isn't it? Sort of having such a huge leap. And it really is interesting in terms of, you know, the intervals. Fourth, fourth, second, fifth. Sort of secundal, quintal, quartal. And we've got that pedal A. And then G sharp 7 over A. And all of that, that's just another retardation. In other words, an upwardly resolving suspension, which is prepared on a chord tone in a weak part of the beat, suspended on a downbeat, on a strong part of the beat, and then resolves upwards on a weaker part of the beat. So there's no point, again, just saying what chord it is, that the chord is A. It's just got a big appoggiatura. Like that. Then F7 over E. Amazing. So it's a really good example of wrong bass note in that one. I think I might write that in. Wrong bass note. In other words, having a bass note which is not part of the chord at all. Yeah, so if you put them all together, it's really interesting. So it's sort of diatonically wrong, if you see what I mean. So the E flat is just the extension of the F, but E flat isn't in necessarily the key signature of F major, but E natural is. So yeah, it's a sort of interesting one. Not sure whether it's worth doing a pitch set for that, because it's just part and parcel of what he does. And it adds that little bit of lemon juice. There's something not quite right with Anakin. It's not, he's not just innocent. There's some segment here. There's something. There's a DNA. There's a motif here that he's going to turn into the Dark Lord of the Sith, or one of them anyway. So E7 flat 5 over B flat. And then just a suspended A chord. So that's our phrase one. Then we've got the harp entering. And we exactly the same. And then slightly different. So all of those sort of bass suspension. And then an appoggiatura, like that. B half dim. Another suspended chord. Really beautiful, isn't it? And then we're into phrase three. So it's a real sort of slush of what's going on. A minor add two. And it's an amazing sort of canonic augmentation. So we got C, B, A, look, but it's all in it's all in crotchets instead of quavers until that point. And it's sort of broadly following the same outline as the melody. And then until it gets to there, so it sort of cascades down, and then another appoggiatura like that. So here it's just a simple voice swap like that. With a passing chord. So E minor, first inversion, chromatic passing note. So D minor, but with an F in the bass. And this. Is sort of similar, that sort of idea. And then we got a little bit of warmth coming there because of the D major. And then suddenly it changes to B. What? And then E minor. So lots of first inversions, and first inversions are often used as sort of wistful things. You'll find it in Elgar's Violin Concerto. No, that sort of idea. So it's that sort of wistful thing, but I find it amazing how he's going from D to be absolutely extraordinary, because it's a real surprise. You know, we've started second inversion, in fact not first inversion, but then it becomes first inversion. And then can't play it. So another sort of triple appoggiatura, and then D major, F. And then a similar thing there that we had there. And that's a complicated bit, because it's sort of not quite resolving at that point. So from the D, and look at where all the notes are. So actually the lowest sounding note is that second violin. So we sort of end up on that chord, which is a sort of D minor 7. But actually it's just an F with an add 4. Then F. Another chromatic passing note. So another D major move. And then... and then just a sort of chromatic descent, but it's masterful. So he doesn't use the E there. I would have used an E. But there he does that, so... he just uses G minor. Comes into C, that's where we have our phrase 5, slight change, then we're into F minor, G minor. So really extraordinary, that bit from 25. Let's see whether I can do it on the full score, if I can find it. Really, really extraordinary. So a couple of bars before. Just brilliant. Absolutely amazing. Just voice leaning wise, it's really extraordinary. I mean, it's probably easier to look at just that bit in the wind. Yeah, so the real change is those two chords, isn't it? It's going from that F minor to an F major with an appoggiatura D. So really extraordinary. So it's sort of... it's that change, it's amazing. And then going from the F, so from... so F major then to that G minor with a B. And then we got that turnaround. Really, really lovely cadence going into the phrase 6 with the A section changed. So again. Slight change with the D minor over the A. And then... and this is where we it takes on the Imperial March mantle in the climaxes of the phrase. So it's really, really extraordinary. Let's listen to it again on here. Happens again. That horn part. Absolutely amazing. And that really is the absolute, you know, really pulls at the heartstrings at that point. Really extraordinary. And, you know, the melody is quite straightforward to follow because it's just that. We've got our bass line, which is just a static A, up until so actually the bare bones of it are sort of quite simple, but it's everything else that goes with it that makes it sort of really poignant. So interesting to look at the brass and the wind. I mean, just bizarre, isn't it? Let's do that all together. That doesn't sound right at all. Definitely going to be checking that. Where are we? 29. I think I've just put it in the wrong place. So it should be starting at 30. Yeah. What's odd is... That should be at 30. That should be at 31. Weird. Oh well, I'm just going to get rid of it for now. So, yeah, let's just sort of copy that. So that is from 30. Well, here we go. We've got a fun thing. That's already there. Yep, so that's fine. So you can see how this works. 31 is there. So does that occur there? No. So what is going on there? So harp at 32 should be doing that. That was at 30. So I think that is... No, wait a minute. That's very strange. 31, 32. Yeah, 31, 32. Don't think that should be there. Let's do there. That's better. There we go. And then let's go to 33. There we go. So, where are we? Deeding. That should be there. Oh dear. There we go. So I might just have to put that on a different screen. So, so if we make that voice one, voice two. that's got to be in A flat. And that's probably yeah. It's just copying that. Let's see whether we can do it quickly. There we go. There we go. I did get there. So the most climactic bit of the whole thing I managed to screw up. Never mind. These things happen. Let's just check what's happening with that at 29. Nothing at 29. Nothing at 30. So that's clarinets, and then it's, yeah, so then it's flute. There we go. We're all fine. Okay, so back to what it was. So doo 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 dum. Amazing. Wonderful. That's this sort of, you know, as it takes on that Imperial March, and then it just repeats with a wonderful horn. It reminds me of the end credits to E.T. Actually, there's a bit of a similarity, that sort of real appoggiatura. That sort of thing. It has that sort of same quality. Not as memorable, I don't think, necessarily, but maybe equally as memorable. I mean, it's one of the most extraordinary bits of music in the whole franchise, really. Absolutely, you know, completely. And I love the fact that it repeats that sort of climactic bit, that echoes of Beethoven 7 slow movement. There's definitely an echo. Brilliant. And it's that lovely sort of, like that. I think that should be an A. Sorry about all the mistakes. But anyway, that's then occurs, and then it goes into the what is the alternate ending. So before it just has a very quick ending, but here it sort of starts again, so exactly the same as the two bar intro from the beginning, and then it goes back into A with a B over A. Really amazing. I love that little turnaround here. So in a that sort of bass suspension, and I love that with a long passing note. That's the last thing we hear, that sort of lovely harp ad-libbing at the end. The last chord of the Phantom Menace. Thanks for staying with me. Yes, indeed. So apart from our little sort of slight debacle at the in the big climactic thing, it's such a wonderfully written piece, and really it all comes from these sort of appoggiaturas, all these leaning notes. Everything else is sort of, you know, reasonably straightforward. But not straightforward to compose at all. I mean, you know, there's one thing to orchestrate, there's another thing to actually just write the whole thing. And that's such a talent. I mean, really, really extraordinary. You know, his B sections, these sort of descending bass lines. And then it picks up. And then another descending. Descending bass. Another descending bass. Another descending bass. So it's really extraordinary. If we sort of have a look at what's going on here. Like that. Climbs up. So it sort of descends, but octavely. Amazing. I love it. Really, really extraordinary. Love that. And then it turns around in the D minor bit, and then in phrase 7 it really takes on this sort of mantle. Well, phrase 6 and 7. Absolutely brilliant. And it's just a sequence. But those harmonies, the harmony. Is marvellous. And it's all of those leaning notes which really give it that sort of. That quality. Really remarkable. And it's remarkable to sort of end the whole film on such a sort of dark. note as well. You know, there's no sort of triumphalism at all about that. And it's, you know, we know that the Emperor will eventually be revealed in the subsequent films at that point. And there's also the whole sort of aspect of drama, which sort of often gets overlooked with these sort of film score things, you know, with end credits. There's nothing on the screen apart from the credits, but it is interesting where the sort of composer's allowed to sort of let rip a little bit. I always stayed for the credits in Star Wars films because the music is such an extraordinary part of the film, and so poignant. This one, Anakin's theme, I think it's probably one of my favourite themes in the whole of the franchise, and actually just worth watching the film just for that, quite frankly. Even if you don't like Jar Jar Binks and anybody else, it's got some marvellous music to it. Part of the reason why I did The Phantom Menace was A, because I liked the music, and B, because I didn't want to screw anything up doing a sort of like the original or The Empire Strikes Back. But also it has that sort of interesting quality with, you know, having come away from the franchise for such a long time and then coming back to it. You know, what did Williams do? What, if anything, new did he do? And really the new stuff is all of this starkness, all of these sorts of, you know, column-esque things, interspersed with this sort of passionate, sort of romantic, sort of poignant, dramatic themes as well. And Anakin's theme, you can't really get much more dramatic than that. So thank you for staying with me. It has been an absolute pleasure to present the film to you. I've been working, I think, for 18 months on and off to do it, bringing out weekly videos. We got there in the end. So I think on the main thing, it's track 67 or something like that, which is crazy. I didn't do the absolute opening titles and the fanfare. That's the only thing I didn't do. But I will do those for Empire Strikes Back, which will be the next one, I think. Until then, I am going to be dipping in and out of some other films. But thank you for staying with me, and it's been an absolute pleasure.